Hello, I'm Leon Herszon, head of IIL Consulting, and would like to welcome you to our Inside Stories podcast. Today's guest is Kevin Smithwick, and I would like him to introduce himself. So, Kevin, could you share a little bit about yourself, your background, your career?
Leon, first, yes, thanks kindly for inviting me. I've been looking forward to this. We've been working together for a couple of years now, and it's been a great partnership between our organizations. Today, but just before I talk about my background, I know we're looking for project management experience, and I've got some stories. My background also includes Six Sigma's Master Black Belt, and I've got some stories that I think your audience might enjoy that kind of weave the two. They're not isolated pillars. How I got into it, my career, my undergrad was in engineering, and I started off in the automotive industry, working for a large Canadian company, born and raised in the Toronto area. And my first project, as far as my professional career, let's say, in my 20s, was as the project manager to launch what is called the body side claddings on the Lincoln Town Car. This would be around, you know, the mid-90s. The four pieces between the front wheel and the rear wheel, the rear quarter extension, the front fender, and the two body sides. Did that for a couple of years, launched it to one of their plants, and then the company asked me if I would move to Michigan and be on more of the design side. So I did do that. Picked up and relocated to the greater Detroit area, which is where we're located, stayed with Ford, and worked on running boards on the F-Series truck and the Navigator. So the running boards were kind of my thing. But while I was doing that, I studied my MBA in night school. And then upon completing that, I was looking to grow and expand a little bit. And the company had just started a Six Sigma program, and they were selecting 10 black belts. They took it very seriously. Again, think of the year 2000 here, and Six Sigma was really starting to get popular as a methodology for continuous improvement. So we had to interview with the CEO. I got the position. The funny thing, Leon, is out of the 10 of us, I was the only one that was no longer in manufacturing. I was down at the design center, and my peers, the other nine, all had manufacturing type projects. And I learned pretty quickly that the type of projects that would help the organization from where I was located weren't really the DMAIC classic Six Sigma. They were designed for Six Sigma. So I got into that, enjoyed it very much so. And then when the industry started to change dramatically, if you recall back around 2005, when Ford, GM, Chrysler all went with their hat in hands to the U.S. government asking for bailouts.
Yeah.
As they went to the U.S. government on their private jets. That's the time I left the industry, and I moved over to the med device industry and out to the greater Boston area. And again, in both industries, I've spent my time both on the manufacturing side and on the product development side. So manufacturing, again, I did a lot of large-scale projects, footprint-type projects, while I was in the Boston area for one of my companies. I was even the site director for a pharma plant down in South Carolina. And then recently, the position I've been in, which I've engaged with you, I am currently one of the directors of the Global Project Management Office, where I run the process, the bench strength, the continuous improvement on it.
Very nice. So tell me, Kevin, what made you choose medical devices? Was that something that you had in mind first? What motivated you to pursue a career in this industry?
Yeah, it's a very robust industry is what I learned. Automotive, really any consumer goods, when the world, not just the country, you know, America sneezes and the world gets a cold, right? When the world goes into some sort of recession, consumer goods, including vehicles, people don't buy them. You've got other things more important in your life. There are some recession-proof industries. I don't know if anyone is entirely recession-proof, but med device, healthcare doesn't stop, right? Yeah. People do get sick, and there's always reimbursements by government, whether you're in Canada where the government, they've got a real strong program of reimbursement, and there's little that the citizens have to pay, or whether it's funded by organizations that people work through when the governments do reimbursement. The need is always there. The device is always required. So it was a very safe industry to move into. Challenging though, Leon, it's because it's so unique. automotive, as an example, is primarily self-regulating, where, you know, you've got the FDA, you've got TUV, you've got Health Canada. Going by my experiences, every nation has a governing body like that. So it's tough to get in, because if you're not familiar with how it works, the companies that are looking for people in at least a semi-leadership position are looking for people with experience in the industry. You know, the funny thing, it wasn't my MBA or my engineering degree. It was my Six Sigma background that got me into the industry. So I was able to leverage that. And from there, I've grown within the industry. It's been almost 20 years now. I moved out to Boston in 2006. So we're, 18 and a half years into me being in this industry.
Very nice, very nice. And when you reflect on your journey, right, you have different industries, several experiences. What would you consider your most significant achievement to date?
Yeah, most of my time, Leon, I've been on initiatives, very large scale projects. Just so you can appreciate the scale, when Tyco Healthcare separated from the Tyco org and they were rebranding, which they became Covidien. Covidien doesn't exist because Medtronic has recently took them over since I left the organization. I was the PM for implementing that brand architecture across the organization. That was probably the most challenging, but I think the most rewarding, Leon, was my first real job in Six Sigma. After I became a DMAIC, the classic Six Sigma reactive problem solving, a black belt in that, I put a system in place to better understand how we can improve upfront, the proactive side, right? Not problems that exist, but how can we ensure that they don't occur before they exist? So me being on the design side, I'd had experience as a design engineer, so I knew the process as well. And being a very large tier one, we made everything but glass and tire. I'm going back to my automotive days now. We were responsible for any design changes that were driven by design changes that came from either our manufacturing plant or by corrections we had to make in our design. If the OEM, Ford, GM, Chrysler, Toyota, if they changed something, they would have to pay us for it. If it was our change because we were making a correction or following something or trying to improve, it was on us. So I put a data collection system in place that started tracking, okay, where are we paying, where are we not paying? And then a second data collection system that started tracking, well, what's the nature of the change? Is it a surface change? Is it a tolerance change? Is it a design for assembly type change? Manufacturing camp? We had a good array of data, and I was able to use that data to then pitch to leadership that, hey, I think this is the right thing to do. I partnered up with someone that knew design for Six Sigma, a consultant that I've kept in touch with for many years now, and got trained and brought a first wave of training along with me, and ended up launching the design for Six Sigma, so that in the design center in Michigan, where all our product development came from, 100% of it for all North American vehicle production, we had all our engineers starting to learn how to be black belts and use these proactive techniques, not really changing the overall process of how they do product development, but a lot of tools and methodologies that they can kind of leverage that enables more proactive thinking, bringing manufacturing in early, selecting the right materials, selecting the right processes that can easily be manufactured with good flow on the manufacturing end and limited defect reduction. Meanwhile, as we brought some of these methodologies and presented them up to the OEMs, let's just stick with Ford as an example, and show them why we're tolerancing this way and what our limitation, they said we've never seen analysis like that. So it made the organization look a lot stronger, and we ended up coming up with more robust designs. So I think that was kind of my pet, Leon, my first initiative where I was kind of given free range to launch something. So that one's near and dear to my heart.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. So you a couple of years ago, you decided to develop a project management methodology within your organization, right? What was the reason, what was the problem that you were trying to address when you decided to have this type of initiative to create a unified or something that go across the board project management methodology?
Yeah, so that was with a company that I'm currently with, and I've been with them for 3.5 years now. So this is me as in the global PMO. And we, again, the same way I did with Design for Six Sigma, use baseline metrics to establish where you are. We hired a large consulting company, someone you know of. They've got a very large global footprint. If I mentioned the name, you'd know exactly who they are. And they compared this company to where we were across industry standards. And we were a laggard on every single metric,
oh, wow,
going to market, delays, over budget. And it varied. We have three major regions. We have North America, we have Europe, and we have Japan. So there was differences across the regions. But those metrics came up with basically our KPIs and how we compared, not within ourselves. We already knew we were tracking our own trend data on what our delays, our over costs were, but how did we compare across industries? So we realized our bench strength needed improvement. There's variation across the regions. When you hire a project manager in North America, more often than not, they're PMI certified. If you hire a project manager in Europe, more often than not, they're IPMA certified. IPMA has various levels, so you can, people graduate to being introductory project manager to very mature project manager. Japan doesn't really have that. They do follow PMI, but they don't really have a strong project management culture that's holistic of the entire product development process. The project managers that we had there were typically R&D engineers. So they cover the R&D side of the project, which is a lot of it, right? The QMS, the quality management system, if you're not familiar with the medical device industry, they have to follow that. But there's another side of product development that does not belong in the QMS. Just to briefly explain that, Leon, for any audience members that are outside of this industry, the QMS is everything that the notifying bodies, let's just stick with FDA, cares about. The efficacy of the product, is it safe, right? Everything that is in design control and process control and you put in your validation reports is what the FDA cares about. What they don't care about is how profitable you are, the business case, your time to develop the product, how much waste is in the system. They don't care. These are all business deliverables. So that's the other side of the equation. So if our project managers are strictly R&D, they've got the QMS side well, but they lack on the business case, which is the profitability of the organization. You don't want to be launching into a new market. The gestation time for new product development in medical devices, roughly 4 years, give or take, right? Depending on the complexity of the project. You could be 3 years in, and all of a sudden the threat of new entrants into this market, you've got a competitor out there that's got something better than what you're currently developing. That needs to be considered as you're developing. So they were some of the issues that we ran into that decided we needed to really develop robust project management globally.
Very good, very good. So you created the methodology to you hire a partner to do that with you. You guys created the methodology. How did you roll out that methodology? How did you implement it? Because one thing, yes, you created, and then you have to get the buy-in, you have to get people to use it and see the value. How did you do that?
Yeah, and my relationship with Leon has matured over the past few years. Leon did not walk into the contract. I aggressively sourced Leon against some of his competitors, and I'm delighted with where we landed. But where we started is we put foundational training in place. Project management training at the beginner, the intermediate, and the advanced level. And we started deploying that across the regions to the project managers themselves. It was great, Leon. This was in COVID time, so we were virtual, but unfortunately, you guys were equipped to lead a course that was robust enough. This was about 54 hours of training, and what I appreciated is we had a lot of PMs who were not certified PMs. They were able to use the points that they achieved, because you guys are registered with PMI and IPMA, to actually count towards our certification project managers. So that was our PM training. It couldn't end there, though. We did roll out a brief version for what we call our core team members. Think of R&D, quality, regulatory, legal, every function, supply chain, manufacturing, you name it, right? We rolled that out so that they did not become experts in project management. The PM is the expert in project management, but these are the people that are the subject matter experts in the actual tools themselves. So the methodology, right? Not the methodology of it, but the subject of what's going into your project plan. As an example, the regulatory core team member on a team will know how to put a regulatory dossier together and a regulatory landscape. What markets are we going to? What's required to launch and get a project registered in China as opposed to India, as an example, because every nation's got their own uniqueness. So we want them to be the subject matter experts on what it takes to do it, what the task is. If we look at our work breakdown structure, the PM knows how to manage a work breakdown structure, but they don't know what actually goes into it, how long it takes, what the resources are. So we wanted our core team members to get familiar with how to work with project managers. And then the third thing that we did, Leon, as far as education, is we took an even more abridged version. I think it was about 2 hours, and taught leadership, the people that core team members report to, this is what your department needs to do to integrate with project management. And this is what we'll be expecting of your core team members, the people that report to you. This is how they're going to integrate with the project managers. That was kind of our start, Leon.
Okay, so if I understand correctly, and that was actually attached to the next question I would ask you, is about the key success factors, right, for you on launching that. And I understand not just launching the methodology, but getting people to understand project management best practices in all different levels, right? And then when you launch the methodology through a workshop or something like that, then it was well received because they already had that knowledge. Is that true?
Yeah. Let me expand on where we took it, because we've re-engaged with IIL since then. The bench strength of project management skills we found was effective for project managers, less effective for core team members. They came in, they got their strong cup of coffee that gave them a bit of a buzz, but it wore off because they didn't apply the tools 2 months down the road type thing. Where we took it, now that the academics were in place, is we took it to the applied side, and we started launching what we call project planning workshops, of which we engage with you, and we even put a playbook in place that steers us on how to do that. And the project planning workshops are taking a project in virtually any phase of the project. Obviously better to start early, but with some projects they're being grandfathered in, they're already basic phases of product development in medical device concept, feasibility, development, qualification, launch. If a project's further along in their feasibility or qualifications, it's still worth doing them. But these are great workshops to have when you're in the concept stage. And really what we tried to do, Leon, is for whatever stage we were entering, let's just say it's concept. We've just come out of the market opportunity. We realized that this is a business case here, and it's worth pursuing this project to launch it into production in 4 years' time, let's say. What we wanted to do with every workshop is have the PM coordinate the workshop with the core team members and lay out the project plan in great detail for whatever phase they're entering. That's about a year, let's say. So it's a work breakdown structure, all to do in detail. You're getting down into the work packages, and then you lay out for the next phases beyond this first phase exit, like feasibility, development, qualification, launch. You've got the milestones laid out for that. But the team knows they've now got a project plan in place that identifies the successors. So what task can't start until another task is complete, implying what the predecessors are, the durations, and the estimated resource and budget to do it. The second thing that was important to augment that project plan was understanding the project risk, not the technical risks that go into the QMS that I mentioned that the FDA cares about, the efficacy of the product, but the project risk. What can cause it to be delayed? Yeah. And then from that, build a risk registrar, understand what your mitigation plans are for that risk registrar, and then take that mitigation plan and build it back into the project plan. So if you need, you know, maybe the project plan says, okay, we got to do prototyping. Okay, there's a high risk in that because we're working with something new or a new supplier, a new vendor. Okay, we may need to put in contingency planning of a couple rounds of prototyping. Now your project plan is more accurate. You don't just have the one round and all of a sudden blow your schedule. You've now got a project plan that's got the risk built into it and the mitigation for it. Your work to date is the date that you may get it right in one round of prototyping. But what you're telling leadership, your promise to date is with the three rounds. So you may bring it in quicker, but you're typically not at risk of going longer at that point. So by doing that with the core team members now, who, as I say, they appreciated the training, but they kind of forget it because they didn't use it. They're in a workshop now where these are interactive workshops where they're living it. They're actually going through it and building out the work breakdown structure and building out the risk registrar. And they come out of it much stronger because they've had applied skill sets now rather than just academic.
And those workshops were real projects, right?
Absolutely. We only did it. Just like in my Six Sigma days, we would not allow a belt candidate to enter any of these workshops or training without having a project previously identified. So, and the nice thing is because by doing this on real projects, we wrap up the workshops with a presentation showing leadership. This is where we are, and this is what we've developed, and we now have confidence. So leadership now sees that this is actually a robust project plan, and with the considerations that were put into it. So absolutely. And the thing is, by working on real projects too, the core team members know that, hey, this is work we got to do anyhow. We're now in a huddle for whatever, a four-day workshop coming out much further along. And the feedback we get from the people that attend these workshops, they may be a little disgruntled going into the workshops. What am I doing this for? I'm busy. They come out of it realizing, wow, that was absolutely value added.
Very nice. So you shared a great success case, but I assume you also had some challenges during the process, right? Was there any challenge on each, whatever the part was, and how did you overcome those challenges?
Yeah, and anyone that doesn't reflect after they've launched an initiative is not going to really learn and end up repeating maybe some of the stuff they did the first time, right? I think we were successful. I would not have done the core team training. I think moving quick, getting the PMs up to speed and moving right into the workshops, I think would have been much more beneficial. Some of the challenges, though, is we're a global organization. Our revenue is around the $7 billion mark. And we have three major regions that I mentioned where our development centers are, North America, Europe, and Japan. The cultural differences between those regions are significant. All three unique, and all three have their strengths and opportunities. And trying to put a one-size-fix onto all three isn't necessarily the right way to go. In North America and Europe, as I mentioned, most PMs you hire already have some sort of certification behind them already. In Japan, it's not really that way. And I'll speak general, not stereotype, but just a generality. A lot of the culture in Japan, the people that work for us in this organization, they've been with us for 20, 30 years. You come out of college, you get hired in, and you learn. They rotate people through the organization. They do a great job doing that. But you understand your organization very well. You don't necessarily understand the industry very well. When in North America, for example, I've been in the industry for coming up on 20 years, and it's my four companies. One company was very brief. So I don't job hop. I've spent a good 7 years in the companies before I move on. But by spending that time in those companies before moving on, you're rich. You learn new things that you wouldn't have considered before. And you take that experience, not the property, but the intellectual experience that you gain from it, and apply it to the new organization. It just opens up your mind a little bit. And Japan, you need to be a little bit more proactive that they're still open to new ideas and they want to do the right thing. But the ideas might not necessarily come from within that region of the organization. You have to kind of bring them along with what you think. A more directive model, empowering the project manager rather than the leadership kind of making the decisions of those project managers. So the cultural norms, you have to be appreciative of it. And if we got time, Leon, I'd like to send you another story on PM empowerment, but please.
Oh yeah, thank you. No, we want to hear all stories you have to tell. That's really great, Kevin. So a couple years passed since you started this initiative. How it is right now? After those couple years, any maybe unexpected benefit that maybe you got from all this?
Yes, and it's difficult to quantify. As I mentioned, we're a couple years into it, but I did say that the gestation time for medical device industry is roughly 4 years, right? Some projects are easier, line extensions, you can get them done in 2 years, but breakthrough projects, 4 years, 5 years, depending on the technology that's inside there. I've seen projects, outliers, Leon, that were 10 years. Now, these are primarily because we're not using the right metrics to determine the project. Maybe it was a pet project by someone in leadership, or the market change, scope creep, you name it. But what I'm trying to say is that in order to see organizational change, it's not like these ships that can turn on a dime, these new cruise ships now. It's more like the Titanic, that it's slow to move, because you may see benefits on a project, but you're trying to quantify a benefit for a problem that never happened because you've applied the tools correctly and you were smoother to launch. Would you have been so successful had you not applied these methodologies? How do you know, right? So in order to really understand if you're making a difference or not, you need aggregate data that measures the KPIs that I mentioned, you know, 10 minutes ago, and start to determine, is the organization overall getting better? Are our KPIs getting stronger? Our time to market, we're not running over budget, we're not running over schedule, we're understanding what the project risks are earlier, and we're putting triggers and mitigation plans in place to take care of those risks. So yes, on some certain projects, we're seeing some benefits, but until we kind of get more aggregate data and more projects going through this methodology, it'll be, I'm hesitant to say conclusively. I'm confident we will. I don't have the data to back it.
You need time. We need time, right?
Need a bit more time, but it's coming. And as I say, you know, the intangible benefits, morale, the team, they come to these workshops and they're engaged. You know, you meet your team members. We always do team building. It's not one function, quality, supply chain, manufacturing, regulatory, they're not all working in silos. You're bringing them together. So, but these are intangible benefits. You haven't necessarily brought the project to market sooner, but you've got a core team that's much more engaged. And let me tack on to that a little bit, Leon. We're starting to use the agile methodology. Uh-huh. And I think maybe the company I'm at, we're one of the laggers. When we engage with you to do project management training, you guys had a module on Agile. So it's out there. We know industry's got it. But just quickly, Agile is the execution of the project. So the workshops that we're doing complements Agile very well, because what Agile does is takes that project plan, the work breakdown structure, and starts to turn them into scrums, like a certain number of months, let's just say a 3 week or a 2 month or a 4 week, a scrum, where you take that section of the project plan and the team is kind of in mode where they're plowing through it. When you're putting the project plan together, and this is the whole project planning workshops, the PM is still looking for the subject matter expert from those functions to say, this is how long it's going to take me to do this task. And if they say it's going to take me 3 months to do this task, they will take 3 months to do this task, right? Because they ramp up, and when the due date's getting closer, they complete their task. So the project plan from the methodology is great, but the agile methodology is the execution. And you start moving these things quicker. We're in our infancy with launching agile, but we're anticipating that we should have smoother execution of it. So I wanted to mention Agile because it's extremely complementary to the workshops. Agile does not develop the project plan, it's the execution of the project plan. So you still need the workshops to create the project plans, the risk registrar and the contingency reserves. The Agile is in the execution portion.
Okay. All right, so look into the future. Let's take a look into the future now. And based on your experience and everything that you are planning to do, how do you see new technologies impacting your line of business? And of course, I have to ask about artificial intelligence. So what is your take on that?
So it's interesting. I've done projects throughout my career that has resulted in outsourcing. I moved for my previous company, which was around a $12 billion company, for all North American accounts payable. I ended up moving all four of those processes, merged them into one process, and then we moved them to Malaysia to process. Okay, there's accounting that has now been outsourced, essentially, right, due to the labor cost, essentially, for what was a labor-intensive process. If I look at some of the trends right now, and you know, you look at the improvement of robotics globally, right? I remember back in the day in the 80s, these machines, and they were great. You remember my automotive industry, we saw a lot of robotics going on there. The catalyst for this type of stuff, and this is conjecture on my part now, Leon, take a look at, you know, in California, they've got the new $20 minimum wage for entry-level starter jobs, fast food industry type of stuff. That's tough to pay while keeping the price of the burger something that someone that maybe can't afford Ruth Chris Steakhouse but still wants to go out and have a meal with their family, they're paying a lot more for this now. And I think that's a catalyst that's going to drive more technology into those type of industries. So accounts payable is labor intensive. Flipping burgers is labor intensive, but these are entry level jobs. You don't typically expect people in those positions to really spend their entire career in them, right? They may be the second job in the family, in all respect to people that are in those jobs. But when you may be pricing those jobs out of the market, where I would not be surprised if more technology, more of these places, specifically the franchises, start implementing technology and going with much fewer staff. So the impact on the people that are receiving the $20 minimum wage is going to, I think, end up laying a lot of those folks off. AI is a different animal altogether. You kind of think that there's some jobs that are safe, engineering, right? But AI, you know, you see some of the downside when you get into politics of it. Let's not go there. AI for R&D engineering, you know, R&D engineers are always looking for the best technology out there to make sure that, hey, we're designing this the right way. You come up with a concept, you know what you need this to do, but it's up to the creativity of the engineer and the team to figure out how to do it. And I could see AI being leveraged to a massive degree. I don't know if we're there yet, but I don't think we're far from it, where AI is going to be able to have the information of the globe at its disposal and can find it quickly. And I think it's going to come up with engineering options for some of these challenging poser type designs that are coming down the pipe. Of course, we're going to be leveraging AI for that, right? Because AI, you would hope, is going to get mature enough and robust enough that it's going to give you the best solution. So I probably made my point there, but I think there's I think it can be leveraged for the good. And I think who knows where exactly it's going to go, but I think it's endless, right? You just look at the exponential curve of technology on society over the past decades, and it really is exponential. So I think there's big things to come. The impact will be interesting to monitor. My son's in grade 10. He's in the robotics club. And let's see. I think he's going to have a bigger challenge than perhaps I did.
Very nice. I still have a couple of questions, but before that, I want you to share one of your stories, please.
And I did mention, thanks, Leon, for that. I was hoping you'd come back around to that, because I mentioned project management and how I've been able to merge my Six Sigma experience in with it. And I think if you can find PMs that have that kind of good structured problem-solving methodology and they're experienced at it, the example I'll share with you is I was moving a factory from the greater Boston area, where the company I was with, all the equipment, not the disposables, but the equipment, we were moving to a very large contract manufacturer positioned in Malaysia. I won't mention the name. You've heard of these guys. They've got a huge footprint. They started off as a board shop many decades ago, but they are a full service contract manufacturer now, the kind of organization that tries for 7 inventory turns a year. The company was at, man, we were lucky if we got one turn a year. It's brutal, right? So the device itself was a complex device, and leadership kind of taught, well, you're not doing the disposables, which has all the variation. It's a box build. It should be easy to move. Well, the device had a GUI that was fully interfaced. It had a centrifuge. It had all kinds of controls and everything in there. And just so you know, the price to manufacture the product was $10,000. That's not our selling price. That was just to manufacture, putting it together. So this was a complex device. And the factory we were moving it to in Malaysia, the most complex piece of equipment that they were currently manufacturing was a blanket warmer. So this was new to them. They got the contract. We had a whole floor, greenfield, white space available. We're putting in everything, the checking, the testing equipment and everything. And they started manufacturing. And if we started ramping down our manufacturing in the Boston area, we were starting to ramp up in the others. We had to get them validated and certified. So there's a lot of work to do to get them up to that speed. But at some point, we were closing down production. And what we didn't have in inventory, we were going backward. Issues started happening. These guys were not as mature as they should have been, and screws too loose or a misassembly, and there was just quality issues that were just persistent. The straw that broke the camel's back is we revved a drawing, took it from whatever, A, B to A, C, because minor change had come through. They acknowledged the rev and were shipping to that new rev, but they never implemented it on the floor. They were still building to the previous rev, right? So that was it. And when I mentioned earlier, Leon, you want to empower your project managers. I wasn't given carte blanche, but I was able to go to my leadership, the COO essentially, and say, look, I don't want to buy one more device from this company until we go and we fix this stuff. And he knew me from my previous life. He knew I was a master black belt, and he kind of trusted me to do it. So that I had that in my pocket. But I went out there to Malaysia. We built a war room on the production floor, basically. And because we stopped production, you can just imagine a large contract manufacturer. Okay, we've got their attention now, right? And they knew they needed to fix this too. But what we did, out of all the Six Sigma, and the people think, stats is technical and all that stuff. This is a really simple story, Leon, and I'm sharing this one with you because anyone can do this. If anyone is outsourcing manufacturing, or if anyone's in a similar situation or similar problem, this was easy to fix. What we did is on the war room on the floor, we implemented the major thing was what we called a buddy system. And think of those old Saturn commercials where someone stops the line. It was the same thing. The assembly line to put this device together, starting from the shell to a finished product worth, you know, $10,000 at the end, as it made its way through, it kept getting bigger and bigger and more assembled. If someone noticed a problem from the previous workstation, they didn't stop it. They just, well, that's not mine. They moved on and got through, and then we fix it at the end type thing. Or we go out to the service, people in field service would end up fixing it. We said, if you find something, you stop the line. And the culture in Malaysia, and let me just back up one bit, because Malaysia, and this is in the Penang area, it's tough to get employees because the Malaysians have such a strong economy compared to their neighbors. You're bringing in people from Indonesia, Nepal, India, even Thailand. that are unskilled. And so, you know, you're expecting them to do stuff. English might not even be their primary language, yet our work instructions, you know, they needed to be translated. How well do they translate? What we did, Leon, is anytime that someone noticed a problem, they stopped the line. They then became, they didn't have to be. If they wanted to opt out, they could, but they always did want to be a part of it, of the solution. And we created a little mini Kaizen. Sometimes it was a big thing. Sometimes it was a couple hours. And most of the time we fix stuff through putting assembly jigs in place. So many of the products, someone put something together and they put these two parts together and it's possible to put them in the other way. Well, let's give them an assembly jig that makes it impossible. Let's pokey yoke the assembly process. And we started doing that. And the results were so quick. We ended up resolving things so quickly, Leon. And then we made the workstations ergonomic. We had people standing there for 9-hour shifts on a hard cement floor. Well, if they're standing, give them an ergonomic mat. Make it easy for them so they're not suffering fatigue as the day wears on. If someone needs a chair and they can use it, give them the chair, right? And then we took it down the line even further, Leon, where we started rewarding people for actually being a part of these solutions. And there was a big display case. And you can start every project that you worked on to make an improvement, or if you led, you get different points. And then you start to take stuff from the display case. It might have been a household good. It might have been a voucher to take your family out to a restaurant, whatever it was. And that was on prominent display. We were so successful in a relatively short period of time, saw benefits in weeks, but within a couple months, we had better quality coming out of this facility in Malaysia than we did from our facility in Boston. And it filtered through the plant, Leon, to the point where, you know, it was a massive facility. And the buzz got out there through this huge facility that the floor that this production line was, I'm not mentioning company names, people started requesting to work on this production line. So it was huge. It was a great benefit, but it was the blend of project management and continuous improvement and thinking outside the box, having brave to stop the line and having empowerment from leadership for the project manager to do what they need to do to fix it.
Great story. Thank you for sharing. I'm happy that I asked, and I'm happy that you shared that, really. So we're approaching the end of our chat. Can you recommend one or two books to our viewers?
Yeah. So we've all read the technical stuff, the self-help, right? So I'm going to kind of take a bit of a twist, Leon, and I'm going to recommend something fun. And my book is Atlas Shrugged, which I read a while ago. When I moved to Michigan, my buddy, a great friend of mine, recommended it to me. And I appreciate Ayn Rand. I'm not saying I agree with everything, but the book itself, and I hear most CEOs have this on their shelf, actually, it explores reason, property rights, capitalism, government, and the impact of how it all fits together. The reason I'm suggesting that, Leon, is because of the diversity of thought.
Thank you for sharing. And we're going to put the name of the book and the author in the titles here. So we can close, Kevin. Final thoughts, any word of advice to our viewers, something that you want to say as your final message for our chat here today?
One final thing, Leon, and thanks for this opportunity again. I was a presenter at a Six Sigma symposium about the year 2001, 2002 in Las Vegas. And the keynote speaker was Jack Welch for that symposium. Wow. Being one of the presenters, and just so you know, I was not presenting with Jack. There were speakers that had the whole forum, and then there were speakers, presenters that broke out into one of three work streams. I was one of the three work stream guys, so I was on the lower end of the presenters for that workshop. But before it started, they had all the presenters kind of a meet and greet, and we got to ask Jack Welch questions. And one question that came up that stuck with me was someone asked Jack, do you have a mentor? And Jack responded, I have many, many mentors. Don't pick one person to learn from. Everyone's got something to teach you. No matter who they are or what their role in the organization is, you can learn from them something. And it was humbling, and it was wise. And I've never forgotten that. Pull experience and learnings from anyone, regardless of who they are.
Thank you. Fascinating conversation. Kevin Smithwick, really appreciate your time. I know you are super busy. Thank you so much again. And I see you next time.
Leon, it's been my pleasure. I always enjoy our conversations, and thanks kindly for inviting me to
this.
Thank
you. My pleasure.